Mainz in Money London, ladies and gentlemen, and we are back here with Professor Dr. Thorsten Denin, the head of asset management from Asset Management Switzerland. Welcome, Thorsten.
Thank you, Jochen.
We just listened a little bit to your presentation here. It was really interesting, and it looked to me like that you were talking about like the unloved black sheep in the herd of white sheep, and that's uranium.
Yeah, basically the black sheep in a herd of other black sheep. Yeah, when you look at the general mining sector for a couple of years. I also was surprised as the Mainz and Money asked me to do a presentation on uranium. I did this take 2 years ago, and not much actually had changed in the fundamentals of the sector besides the price.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we are now approaching like $26 per pound, and we already interviewed the last 2 days several uranium companies, and there was I talked with Rick Rule also about it. It's quite interesting. So why do you think this is still so unliked?
Yeah, I mean, the miners are dreaming, when you wake up people from the mining side in uranium, they were dreaming about $80 to $90 per pound of uranium, like the good old times. Yeah, they need probably like $40, $45 to make like a decent production. Now we came from this desperation levels, this desperate price levels of below 20 bucks, 18, even 17, I think 80 I've seen in the daily lows on the spot. And now, as you said, we move back into the 20. 25, 26-ish. So uranium price reminds me a bit on the gold price 6 months ago. It just starts to rise, but for another reason than gold. It's more like the crude oil market, where like the OPEC, that's the Kazakh mining guys, are cutting production, and therefore the market supply and demand balance is improving.
Mm-hmm. That means when you say improving, that means we have less supply, but the demand is rising steadily, right? So the gap this year is what, like 60 million pounds approximately?
It's 11, like I think 11% of the overall market. It's quite a lot. Mm-hmm. But inventories are like a big question mark in industry. So there's no actual shortage, but the gap between mine supply and the demand is opening wider. Yeah. So that's a nice development looking forward in the coming years. Yeah. Because the growth basically comes in this decade, from the 2020 to 2030, where we see like electricity generation rising because of population rising, because of
e-mobility, of course.
E-mobility, yeah. Somewhere we need to get all the electricity for e-mobility and for storage.
Yeah, we have to charge somewhere.
Exactly. And then you have like an industry where you have like 10% of global electricity generation, that's uranium. 10%, it's growing, but it will stay at 10%, so that makes it a bit unsexy.
Okay, I see. Why do you think the Japanese have this year not brought online again any more nuclear power plants? I think since Fukushima, I think 7 or 9 it is, they are just online now again. And I read in a market commentary that this was one of the reasons why uranium did not move this year, because there was like no new nuclear power plants in Japan going online. Yeah. But on the other hand, if I look at China, I think they got this year 5 new nuclear power plants online
this year, and just look into the decade, we're operating below 50, and they're doubling this capacity in the next 10 years. So they're adding like 50 new reactors. I mean, the Japanese discussion from my point of view is a bit overrated, because they're coming back slowly. Okay, this year they paused, but they're coming back with 20-25% of the energy mix within 2030. So that's my advantage as an economist. I can say I'm thinking about a decade. I don't need to think in quarters or like in 1 or 2 years. So this is Japan. China is much stronger growth. And the rest of the world added like silently another couple of reactors. Mm-hmm. So we're now at more than 400 gigawatts of installed capacity. That's an all-time maximum. And it's growing further. Mm-hmm. So it's a slow growth, so therefore nobody sees it. Yeah. But the industry is growing, and that makes it sexy, because everybody overlooked it.
Yeah, that's right. And I think also approximately 1 to 1.2 billion pounds are not contracted until 2030 it is. Yeah. So that's also something which is in the market. Where do you see a trigger point that all of a sudden it starts? Because this market reminds me a little bit onto 2006, 2007. Because all of a sudden it started, because first the hedge funds went in, moved it. Then the buyers got nervous, the hedge fund moved it further, and then all of a sudden the buyers had to buy. And it was the hockey stick we got?
Yeah, I think the market fundamentals look quite healthy looking forward. First, you have a supply-demand balance that's in line. The price is slowly to rise. You have a rising demand by population growth. Therefore, I agree with you. It's like the same situation probably 2006-07 on the mining side. But I think the uranium industry has an image problem. Because everybody is talking alternative energy, this is like the super sexy, the big wind power generators, like killing birds, like in a motorway, the solar panels, electric vehicles, everything else on alternative. Lots of money goes into the sector. It's growing faster, but it's more inefficient when you compare it with a nuclear side. But in a quantity, nuclear is only option a couple of countries have to reduce actively CO2 very fast and in big volume. Look at Poland, our neighbor to the east. Yeah, Poland has just signed a contract for a big nuclear capacity, reducing its coal because it's very big in coal mining. Mm-hmm. So this is the effect of like 1/20th of China, but it's a big move into nuclear on that side. I mean, the Germans are good in buying the nuclear energy from other sources because they're shut down. And when you look to China and the air quality, the image problem of the industry needs to get into this CO2 neutral, environmentally friendly approach that Middle East and Asia is pushing for nuclear, and not the Godzilla effect that we see in Japan or like in European heads.
Yeah. So what is your, let's say, estimate for next year and maybe 2021? Could you imagine that all of a sudden prices are rising more to the, let's say, $40 level?
I think this would be an accident if you see prices rise too fast or high. Mm-hmm. My estimate is that we will slowly move the contract price back in line with spot prices increasing to a 35-ish, 40 range, slowly for the next 1 or 2 years. If there's some incident in the industry, it will probably spike. It will spike to a 45, 50, maybe 60, then come down again. So this is the famous trade opportunity is do you have once or twice in the sector. Mm-hmm. But I think the most stable thing for the next coming 3, 4, 5 years is very interesting equity valuation, project valuation, when the structural prices, the contract prices are at a 40-ish dollar level, and then you have lots of value in the assets in the companies.
Fantastic. Thorsten, thank you very much. Great, and let's see what happens. I mean, it's really not easy to predict.
Yeah, pleasure to talk about the black sheep in industry.
Exactly. Thank you very much, Thorsten. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, it was Professor Dr. Thorsten Denin, Head of Asset Management of Asset Management Switzerland. And talking about the real black sheep here in the commodity scene, that's uranium, definitely. Nobody likes it, nobody loves it, and real unloved commodity. But something is going on in the market here, definitely, and the world needs probably, to stick at least with uranium capacities, because it is CO2 free, it is emission free, and probably one of the chances for the future here. And we need a solid baseload in the grid, and this you can only do really with uranium if you want to have it CO2 free. So check it out. Uranium might be hot again in the next 2 years. We will see. Thank you very much, and bye bye from London.